My name is Rasha Drashkovich. I'm a television producer in Los Angeles. I was born and raised in the U.S., and I remember growing up, the name Draža Mihailović always produced a strong reaction. He was a hero in World War II, being the first to rise up against Hitler in occupied Europe. A Hollywood movie and a radio program starring Orson Welles praised his struggles. A recently found archival film of his Yugoslav army, popularly known as the Chetniks, showed them rescuing over 500 U.S. airmen behind enemy lines. But something turned after the war. He was no longer referred to as a hero, but as a villain, and worse yet, a traitor. Our film is an attempt to show you how the media influenced popular opinion, both for and against Mihailović. It's an examination of a man who was caught in the crossfire of history, so powerful that the mere mention of his name today provokes emotion.
Jer počinjemo.
Počinjemo. Kad je krenulo?
Možemo slavo nebeška, sveti aranđeli, sveti Vasilji. Pomoć se mi da izdrži.
This is the Ravna Gora Plateau in western Serbia. The history of this mountainous region is one of struggles against invaders. Not far from here, the Serbian army won the first big battle for the Allies in World War I. But in 1941, Serbia was part of Yugoslavia, which was overrun by the German army. Refusing to surrender, Colonel Mihailović came here in May with 26 men, soldiers from the Yugoslav army, who would soon become the largest resistance force in Europe.
Kad se pojavio, na primjer, Gorski car na Ravnu Goru koji nije porobljen, Draža Mihailović koji nije dozvolio da se porobi njegova cela vojska i da se okupira cela Srbija, srce Srbije, Ravna Gora, Suvobor i Jelica.
On jednostavno, kad je čuo da su se predali, on rekao ja neću da se predam Nemcima.
Officers of the Yugoslav army, who refused to surrender to the Germans, learn that Mihailović is in Ravna Gora and make contact with him. He will lead them in the next 4 years, waging a guerrilla war against the Axis. Mihailović will launch attacks on German communication lines. He will infiltrate his agents into German collaborationist ranks. By 1942, he will raise the largest Allied army between London and Cairo. Mihailović assigns Army Major Žarko Todorović to organize an underground resistance and gather intelligence in the capital city of Serbia and Yugoslavia. Todorović forms the Belgrade Command and recruits students from the Democratic Party.
I mi smo u to vreme vrlo malo komunicirali među nama. Mi smo imali nekoliko grupa, jedna recimo Desimir Tošić je odgovarao za jedan deo Beograda, Marko Krstić je bio odgovarao za drugi deo Beograda. Kad je uhapšen Desimir Tošić, oni su samo uhapsili još četvoricu koji su radili sa njim, a nisu znali za ostale koji su učestvovali u organizaciji Demokratske stranke.
This is pre-war footage of King Peter with Yugoslav army officers. Once in the hills with Mihailović, they will come to be known as Chetniks. Their clean-cut image will change dramatically. Many will don peasant clothing as their uniforms wear out. They will grow beards in keeping with the Serbian guerrilla tradition, but they will formally continue to be officers of the Yugoslav army.
On je zadržao sve elemente funkcionisanja predratne vojske i prosto prema važećem pravilu službe i ratnom planu on je sebe smatrao kao jedan izdanak te vojske koji funkcioniše u geodetskim uslovima.
Naziv je Jugoslovenska vojska i suština je u tome da se on nije menjao posle 6. aprila 1941. Suština je u tome da postoji kontinuitet i vojske i države i monarhije sve do 1945. godine.
When the Yugoslav government went into exile, when it first arrived in London, they were treated as heroes because they had opposed the Axis. You know, they had fomented a coup d'etat. They were seen as brave allies.
In April of 1941, the Germans have one goal: to capture the 18-year-old King Peter. He evacuates to London and joins other exiled leaders, amongst them General Charles de Gaulle of France and General Władysław Sikorski of Poland.
My people are being tested as they've never been tested before. They're resisting heroically under their gallant leader, Draža Mihailović.
He was the first person to, as it were, show any sign of resistance within occupied Europe to Hitler. I mean, there'd been all that catalogue of German victories, and suddenly there was this little chap.
With Benson Price as our master of ceremonies, David Brookman and the Treasury Orchestra and Chorus, and starring Mr. Orson Welles in Violet Atkins' story of unconquered Yugoslavia, the Chetniks.
Termin Četnik ima, dakle, dugu istorijsku tradiciju. To je termin koji je vezan za istorijski kontekst borbe srpskog naroda za oslobođenje.
The Chetniks. In a gloomy forest back in the hills of Yugoslavia, a group of men stand in a half circle around their leader.
On je posle Prvog svjetskog rata ušao u zvaničnu terminologiju kao izraz aktivnosti na onom prostoru koji je za posebnu neprijateljske okupatorske snage.
I imali su četničke jedinice koje su bile udarne jedinice u našoj vojsci i imali su ove specijalne uniforme.
To su bile jedinice za specijalne namene. Oni su preformirali nego što su komandosi britanski formirali nešto. To su jedinice koje su nastale kao potreba za vođenje specijalnih operacija u pozadini neprijatelja.
Before the outbreak of the war, General Charles de Gaulle argued against the Maginot Line, a series of fortifications and tank obstacles, as the French army's plan to stop the pending German attack. He was proven right. Germans overran France in a matter of weeks. Mihailović faced the same situation in Yugoslavia. He criticized the Yugoslav version of the Maginot Line.
On je napravio jedan referat i podneo je ministarstvu vojske, a Milan Nedić je bio ministar vojske. I Milan Nedić njega osudi zbog toga na kućni zatvor.
Nedić blocked Mihailović's promotion to rank of general in 1939, arguing that his guerrilla strategy undermines the Yugoslav Maginot defense against the Germans. In 1941, General Nedić will witness the failure of his Maginot concept.
Došli smo u jednu vrlo zamršenu situaciju u kojoj su dva srpska oficira izabrala dva različita puta. General Nedić saradnje sa Nemcima, pri čemu je i on bio svestan da na kraju rata Nemci neće biti pobednici i da će njemu biti suđeno.
General Nedić, like Marshal Petain in France, decides to yield to the Germans. On August 31, 1941, he forms the Serbian government of national salvation, recognizing German authority.
U Jugoslaviji javio se jedan drugi pokret, posebno od trenutka napada na Sovjetski savez, koji je podržan sa istok.
They are the members of the Communist Party of Yugoslavia, headed by Josip Broz, known as Tito. The Communist Party of Yugoslavia, organizes a guerrilla force, the Partisans. Mihailović and Tito establish telephone communication to coordinate action against the Germans.
Treba shvatiti jednu stvar. Pokret Draže Mihajlovića je uglavnom bio vođen od oficira.
Tek sam izašao iz Jugoslovenske vojske i među ti 20 mi smo udarili na rudnik da oslobodimo kad su pošli Nemci onaj, iz Topole prema Kragujevcu i tuna nam je jedan ranjen da manem rukom kroz usta i jedan nam je poginuo i od 18 nas vratili smo se onda i onda smo onaj zarobili smo nekoliko onaj oružje, dobili smo oružje i onda se postala četa, pa posle postale bataljon i od bataljona postali su korpusi.
Mihailović's men, commanded by the youngest lieutenant colonel in the Yugoslav army, Veselin Masita, take the town of Loznica from the Germans. Masita dies while charging German lines, but the first town in occupied Europe is liberated. Five towns liberated, four more under siege in the fall offensive of 1941. Mihailović issues an order which regulates postal service in liberated Yugoslav towns.
Na Čumićima smo zajedno vodili borbu kad smo ubili 9 vojnika i 3 oficira. Opredelenje je bilo sad ko će da ide na jednu stranu, ko će na drugu. Ja sam se opredelio za moju zakletu. I otišao sam, a mnogi su se opredelili tamo i posle su prišli mene, ima četvorica koji su prišli meni, na primjer, bacili petokrak, a postavili onaj krunu.
Tito je tada bio u stvari u neku ruku podređen, jer on je dolazio kod Draža u štab da pregovara, a ne Draža kod njega. I onda je, kad su se vraćali, jedan od komandanata je rekao Dražim, slušaj, mi ćemo da, kad oni odmora, da ih likvidiramo. A Draža je rekao, ja sam dao reč. I ako neko od njih pokuša nešto da ih napadne, on će biti streljan. To treba sve vama da bude jasno. I nije dozvolio da se mašta desi Titu dok se vrati u svoj kraj gde je bio klonkom. To Tito ne bi učinio sa Dražom.
Kad je Wilhelm, njemački car, na onom telegramu da je kapitulirala Bugarska napisao, zar 62.000 Srba da reši sudbinu rata? Sramota. On koji imao armiju od 2,5 miliona vojnika, gubi rat zbog onih srpskih vojnika na Solunskom frontu. E, takvu ulogu je mogla Balkansko ratište da odigne u Drugom svjetskom ratu. Nažalost, podeljenost u samoj zemlji doveli su do toga da se iscrpljujemo u međusobnom ratovanju, da većina gubitaka koje smo imali su u bratoubilačkom ratu, u građanskom ratu koji je bio među nas sami, a da je to omogućilo okupatoru relativno stabilan sistem okupacije, da iscrpljuje što je moguće više prirodne resurse iz ove zemlje i da ne angažuje svoje prvorazredne te elitne jedinice koje su mu bile potrebne za druge frontove.
Stalin supported Mihailović and actually reprimanded Tito and said, you don't want to be making social revolutions. What you need to be doing is joining forces with the other resistance movement and fighting against the Axis.
It's a long way to Tipperary. It's a long way to go.
But it was not until about the September of 1941 that the first mission, which was with a chap called Bill Hudson, a South African, got through to Mihailović.
Hudson's brief was to go into occupied Yugoslavia, find out who is resisting, report back on who is resisting, and support them in any way they could.
On the eve of the war, Prime Minister Winston Churchill created a special operations agency whose mission was to encourage sabotage and resistance in occupied Europe.
The policy of the SOE was that these various places in occupied Europe would have their secret armies, which would be lying low. And this was why the British army, certainly in 1941 and early 1942, were in favour of Mihailović lying low and not risking.
The towns taken by his men and the partisans in the fall offensive were reclaimed by the Germans, who now want revenge. On September 23, 1941, the German authorities introduce a new policy. For every dead German soldier, 100 Serbs are to be executed. For every wounded German soldier, 50 Serbs will be killed.
Bill Hudson, who was the first SOE officer to arrive in occupied Yugoslavia, arrived shortly after this happened. And he described it very movingly in a BBC interview some years ago, in which he said that every morning and every evening, the women of the town would be out in the fields, wailing and keening. I'm terribly sorry, caught me unawares, but mourning, they were mourning every night and every evening. And he said it was a terrible sort of atmosphere. And it affected Mihailović very badly. And from that moment on, Mihailović felt that he should act as a shield for the people and protect the people.
Prema nemačkim podacima, iz proleća 1942. godine, u ustanku je ubijeno 49.750 Srba, što civila, što u vojnim operacijama, što su za svega nekoliko meseci trajanja tog ustanka zaista drastične žrtve.
Mada je bilo odmazdi, bilo ubijanja, ali tako sistematskog i tako svedeno na matematički izraz, mislim da je bilo samo na prostoru okupirane Srbije.
In an effort to stop the reprisals, Mihailović offers to meet with the representatives of the German army. He arrives to the meeting accompanied by his assistant, Major Alexander Mišić.
The German army is recognized as such by the entire world. How can it be wrong when men fight for their country?
Oh, it's quite simple. We have the right to execute every guerrilla we capture.
As well as the right to starve defenseless women and children?
It's no use discussing human decencies with them, Draja. Give them the ultimatum and let's get out of here.
Mihailović is faced with a demand for unconditional surrender. He refuses and immediately notifies London. However, he asks the Germans to give him time to contact his commanders and relay the offer to them, aware that the German army is actually preparing for an assault. 3 weeks after the meeting, the Germans launch operation codenamed Mihailović. They print a wanted poster with a reward for Mihailović's head of 200,000 dinars. The Germans carry out a parallel offensive against the partisans, codenamed Užice, and push them to the area controlled by the independent state of Croatia, formed in the western part of Yugoslavia with the help of the Axis.
Recimo, Aleksandar Mišić, kod koga je Draža otišao na Ravnu Goru. Draža je otišao u kuću Vojvode Živojina Mišića, a ne na Ravnu Goru, zato što je ona posebno važna.
The Germans surround Mihailović's headquarters in a house in the village of Struganik. A man comes out, surrenders, and introduces himself as Dragoljub Mihailović. But this man wasn't Draža. The man pretending to be Draža was Major Alexander Mišić, Mihailović's assistant and the son of General Mišić. The Germans take Mišić to prison camp, convinced they have captured Mihailović. Major Mišić's sacrifice allows Mihailović to escape unnoticed.
Amerikanci su jugoslovensku vladu u izbjeglištu, samo kralja Petra, koji je ugošćen na najvišem mogućem nivou u Americi, i generala Mihailović i njegov pokret smatrali savezničkim pokretom.
King Peter, boy ruler of Yugoslavia, meets President Roosevelt for the first time. Only 19, the young king comes to seek aid for Yugoslav guerrillas waging war against the Axis.
Mihailović not only survives the December offensive, but comes out stronger, raising a massive army in the spring of 1942. A system of radio stations is established, which allows him to command troops across Yugoslavia. He is promoted to the rank of general and appointed as the chief of staff of the Yugoslav army by King Peter and the Yugoslav government.
It was at the behest of the British that the Yugoslav government in exile appointed Mihailović as their minister of war. And the British gradually began to see Mihailović as the most important element, much more important than the exiled government.
In 1942, Mihailović emerges as the hero of the European resistance. However, the reality on the ground is different. His army has insufficient weapons for serious offensive action.
Hudson and then subsequently Bailey sent out desperate messages saying, send us arms. If you can send enough arms, Mihailović can raise thousands of people, but you need the arms to supply them for resistance, and also to show them that we're serious, to demonstrate to Mihailović that we really mean that we want to support him.
I know that there were commitments made by Roosevelt at the time. I felt as though events subsequent to that sort of overran those commitments. It was largely symbolic. We weren't in a position at the time to follow up much in the way of material support to the resistance. In fact, it will be some time before we can do that.
Mihailović has to avoid action against the Germans because of reprisals. He has no weapons coming from the British. It is time he uses his pre-war nemesis, Nedić.
He also encouraged some of them to join the Nedić State Guard in Belgrade.
Zato što je to jedini način da on pribavi ne samo oružje, nego i informacije.
He was very, very careful and very adamant when he was instructing his own people to do this, that they should always bear in mind that they were his people, not Nedić Chetniks, and that when he gave the signal, they were to desert Nedić and come to him in time for the general rising.
Još jedan izvor oružja, a to je bilo više 42. godine, je bio od strane Srpske državne straže, koji su naši ljudi iz pokreta Draže Mihajlović uspeli da probiju.
E, sada ostaje da se konkretno dogovorimo o isporuci oružja. Gde i kada? Vama to možda izgleda jednostavno, ali nije. Ne vole Nemci te igre ispod žita, tako da moramo biti sasvim diskretni.
The partisans employed exactly the same tactics, because in their area, of course, they had the Ustasha forces. and when it suited them, they ignored them or made accommodations with them or infiltrated them, because that was just as useful from the partisan point of view as the Nedić forces were from the Mihailović point of view.
World War II Yugoslavia witnesses the greatest number of different armies and factions. Serbia alone has 12. One of them is the pre-war Chetnik organization led by Kosta Milovanović Pečanac, who held the title of Vojvoda, a Serbian military leader from the Balkan Wars and World War I. Pečanac decides to join Nedić in recognizing German authority. Mihailović clashes with his forces, but also uses them to legalize some of his units and procure weapons in 1942.
Prisustvo tih četnika, dakle vladinih ili nacionalnih, onih četnika koji su u službi okupatora, dalo mogućnost Mihailovićevoj organizaciji da preživi nemački napad decembra 1941. godine i da se deo njegovih snaga, kako se kaže, legalizuje kroz ove snage. Ali to je bilo samo tokom zime 1942. godine.
Radio Beograd priredio je po prvi put u okviru srpske emisije jedan javan koncert na Terazijama u Beogradu. Svira nemačka vojna muzika.
The hit song of World War II, Lili Marlene, is launched by Radio Belgrade, played on a rare vinyl record brought by a German officer. General Erwin Rommel, commander of the Afrika Corps, telegraphs Belgrade, requesting the song be played more often. It becomes the signature song of his unit, but something else coming from Serbia will bear upon the Afrika Corps.
It was the railway line through Serbia that was supplying reinforcements to Thessalonica, to Rommel in North Africa. And this was of great concern to the British.
1,500 miles away in North Africa.
The battle at El Alamein is entering a critical stage. Rommel's Afrika Corps is now facing General Bernard Montgomery and the British 8th Army.
Tražili su da im daje izveštaje šta tačno ide za Afriku. Koje uniforme Nemci voze, koje trupe, koje naoružanje. Kolega Aleksandar Dinčić pronašao je nemački izveštaj grupe Vineke, koja je pratila diverzantsku grupu Gordon, četničku, odnosno jugoslovenske vojske. Prema tom nemačkom izveštaju, grupa Gordon je izvela 1499 uspešnih diverzija i sabotaža tokom 42. i prvoj polovini 43. godine.
Metoda je bio da se sipa pesak u ulje kojim se podmazuju osovine točkova na vagonima. Posle izvesnog vremena ti točkovi se toliko usijaju da se počnu da tope. Ti vagoni ne vede ništa više.
Germans organize exhibits, starting in the summer of 1942, ridiculing Mihailović's actions. Adolf Hitler sends Heinrich Himmler, the Reichsführer of the elite SS Corps, and the Minister of the Interior to Yugoslavia. Himmler arrives in Kraljevo on October 15, 1942, to inaugurate the SS Prinz Eugen Division, whose first mission is to attack Mihailović's troops located on Kopaonik, the tallest mountain in Serbia. As head of the Gestapo, the German state security, Himmler oversees the mass arrests of Mihailović's agents who have infiltrated with Nedić and Pečanac. Gestapo's code name for Mihailović's secret army is DM Organization.
Unfortunately, many of these people wound up in camps and being deported to Mauthausen as a result of being perceived as infiltrators and spies.
Porodica Draže Mihajlović je bila uhapšena. Kogod je bio od oficira dokazan u neku ruku po kriterijuma Gestapoa da je recimo bio u nekoj značajnoj funkciji Draže Mihajlović, on je bio streljan.
Ukoliko bi ih otkrili da su pripadnici jednog ili drugog pokreta, toliko su pre stradali. I Mihajlovićevi ljudi i komunisti.
Addio, mare. Addio, ljubavi. Za navek idem. Zaboravi. Addio, mare.
Jer većina pohapšenih u Beogradu su bili DM organizacija. Ne zato što je DM organizacija u Jugoslaviji bila mnogo veća nego što je organizacija partizanska, nego iz prostog razloga što Beograd nije bio centar partizanske aktivnosti, dok je Beograd bio vrlo važan punkt organizacije Draže Mihajlovića.
Despite arresting thousands of DM operatives, the Gestapo cannot catch the man responsible for supplying key intelligence to Mihajlović via a secret radio transmitter located in Belgrade. In the early 1970s, a Yugoslav television series on the war showed acts of sabotage, but only those of partisan agents who had infiltrated the Nadic ranks. Any specific actions by Mihajlović operatives were credited to the partisans. Specifically, in one episode called The Radio Station, the writers relied on the Gestapo files on Žarko Todorović.
Kapetan Todorović.
Hello, American.
The U.S. government sponsored war propaganda films made by Hollywood. They supported all allies, including Yugoslavia, with Mihajlović as a focal point. Comic books offered stories of the general and his brave men to the American public, describing him as the Yugoslav MacArthur. One such comic shows him in a triumvirate, alongside Admiral Bulkley, the torpedo boat hero of the Pacific, and baseball star Lou Gehrig. Perhaps the most interesting is the participation of Orson Welles as voice actor and Vincent Price as narrator in a radio program called Chetniks, sponsored by the Department of Defense. Welles is coming off the success of Citizen Kane and his radio drama War of the Worlds.
You are now, each of you, a member of the Chetniks. There is no life for you now but implacable war on the Nazis.
As far as the United States was concerned, I think we had a very romantic view, if you will, of Mihajlović.
He became a hero of European resistance. And, you know, it cheered people up. It made people feel that there was a bit of light at the end of the tunnel.
U tom smislu razvila se i propaganda o herojstvu, o mitskim borbama, o Jugoslovenima koji u planinama ratuju sa nemačkom silom i tako dalje.
What his activities were exaggerated, but that helped because at the time good news was such a premium and people like Churchill enthused about it.
For his efforts in fighting the Axis, Time magazine nominates Mihajlović for Man of the Year in 1942.
And so both Mihailović and the Yugoslav government appealed to the BBC and to other media to tone down this this tremendous amount of publicity. I think I said in the book, you know, the last thing a secret army needs is a worldwide advertising campaign.
The movie Chetniks, The Fighting Guerrillas, starring Philip Dorn as Mihailović, was produced in 1943 by the 20th Century Fox Studios here in Los Angeles. It was the culmination of propaganda. The movie premiered in Chicago in April of 1943, and Mayor Edward Kelly proclaimed that day Chetnik Day in honor of Mihailović. At the same time, the British had their movie called Chetnik being produced at the Ealing Studios in London. However, at the moment of all this glorification, one of Mihailović's allies decides to accuse him of collaboration.
The Soviet Union actually offered the Yugoslav government in exile to send in a mission with a Soviet officer to join Mihailović, which the Yugoslav government was quite enthusiastic about. It. However, the British were not very keen on the idea of a Soviet agent being dropped into Mihailović for a number of reasons, predominantly probably because the British felt it was their show. They wanted to be in charge and they didn't want the Soviet Union interfering with it. In much the same ways later on, they were not terribly keen on the Americans interfering in Yugoslavia.
Anticipating a political divide with the Western allies, the Soviets continue to support Tito as their ideological protege, but abandon their ally Mihailović and decide to treat his infiltration tactics as collaboration.
Braćo Četnici, čujte me! Sad je tren da trgnemo mačeve. Jest! Trenutak odluke pred nama. Zajedno sa nemačkim snagama.
All right, let's stop. Let's stop the film.
Zadaćemo im smrtni udar.
After the war, two blockbuster movies filmed in Yugoslavia, starring Orson Welles and Richard Burton, played a major role in shaping public opinion. However, these movies were also hiding one of the biggest secrets in communist Yugoslavia, Tito's deal with the Germans.
Und wenn sie dann schön eingekesselt sind, dann greifen wir gleichzeitig von allen Seiten an.
Orson Welles plays a Chetnik again. This time as a collaborator who offers the Germans a deal at Neretva River. In reality, it is the partisans who offer the Germans a deal in anticipation of an Allied landing.
An Allied invasion was Tito's greatest fear, because if an Allied invasion happened, then it would give the opportunity for Mihailović, who had far more forces than he had, to become prominent.
The partisans are chased down to Neretva by the Germans in Operation Weiss, meaning white, intended to destroy them. Once Tito learns that the British are drawing up plans for an invasion together with Mihailović, he decides to send a delegation to the Germans.
Three of their top leaders actually went and met up with German officials and actually went to Zagreb and were allowed to visit girlfriends and go to the cinema and to visit their families.
Gilas, Popovich and Velebit were involved in the March negotiations and negotiated with Germans at increasingly high levels. A truce was agreed where they would not fight the Germans. This suited the Germans because it freed them up. They could then turn on Mihailović's forces and wipe them out. At one stage, it seems that the partisans even suggested to the Germans that if there was an Allied landing, they might join forces with them. That may be a bit of PR on behalf of the partisans to make their negotiations more successful.
At Neretva, the British still have no contact with Tito, who is getting dangerously close to the Germans. However, he will soon get British support at Suchiska, a battle depicted in the second movie, starring Richard Burton as Tito.
Hitler naređuje svojim generalima von Leru i Littersu novu ofanzivu protiv partizanskih snaga. Odmah opkoliti, uništiti partizanske udarne jedinice i njihovu vođu Tita. Tako je počela po angažovanosti ljudi i ratnih sredstava operacija najvećih razmera nazvana Schwarz.
Tokom planiranja operacije Schwarz, u tom prvom planu, u čijem diktiranju učestvuje lično Adolf Hitler, partizani nisu spomenuti. Plan se odnosi samo na uništenje Četnika.
The Germans were planning Operation Svarts against the Chetniks. Every possible effort was being made to ensure the Italians did not know of Operation Svarts. They simply did not trust them not to tell their allies certain Chetnik units.
The secret covered up by Tito after the war is that Operation Schwarz, or Black, was initially planned against Mihailović. How did an operation to capture Draža turn into the biggest battle between the Germans and partisans?
Kada su Nemci 17. maja produžili svoj napad i na partizane, pošto su oni umeđu vremenu upali u četničku teritoriju. Kad su već upali u tu teritoriju, Nemci su odlučili da unište jedne i druge, a inače stalno je iz Berlina dolazilo upozorenje da se sa bandama ne pregovara, već da se one uništavaju. E, toga dana je prema Đilasu Broz izjavio, tako nam i treba kada verujemo Nemcima. Na početku operacije Švarc, Mihailović je izbegao nemački obruč, to od strane njihove najbolje jedinice, Pribrske divizije, samo za dva sata. Kod Đalovića, Klanca, kod Brodareva, povukao se dakle na sever. Dva sata posle njegovog povlačenja, obruč je bio potpuno zatvoren.
Tu se vidi koliko je Draža Mihailović bio ovako, imao koncepcije koje su za gerilu značajne bile. Oni nisu uhvatili skoro nikoga.
Oni nisu uspjeli da okruže i unište ni jednu jedinicu jugoslovenske vojske. Međutim, u njihovom obruču se našla glavnina snaga partizanskog pokreta, koji su uspavani pregovorima koji su pre toga vodili sa Nemcima, verovali da do toga, te operacije neće doći.
Njihove glavne snage dolaze iz Grčke, to je prva brdska divizija, 25.000 vojnika, najbolja formacija Nemačka koja je bila ovde, ona je, recimo, osvojila Kavkaz od Crvene armije, i to je 7. SS brdska divizija Prince Eugen koja je dolazila iz Hercegovine. Tako kada je 17. maja 1943. godine počeo taj napad Nemaca i na partizane u operaciji Schwarz, oni su uporno pokušavali da se probiju na jug i uporno su nailazili na najjače nemačke snage i masakrirani su.
The partisans are hit with the largest German offensive to date in the Balkans.
He has lighted a fire which will burn with a...
Winston Churchill delegates a special assignment to Captain William Deakin, his confidant, an assistant in writing the history of England.
Burnt out of Europe.
He arrives with the first British mission to Tito.
Deakin arrived right in the middle of this encirclement. Partisans escaped very, very narrowly.
Mr. Churchill planned a wonderful trip for us, particularly for you, his personal friend.
Yes.
Tito was wounded, I think, and also Deakin was wounded. I think they may even have been wounded by the same shell. So you can imagine, you're a young man arriving in the middle of a huge and terrifying battle on Mount Durmitor. It left a very strong impression on Deakin.
You're going to associate yourself with the people you form friendships. It's natural, it's a normal human behaviour. He didn't meet Chetniks, he didn't meet Mihailović.
Manji deo jedinica sa rukovodstvom, sa Josipom Brozom i delom tog vrhovnog štaba uspeo je da se izvuče žestokom borbom, junačkom. Oni su na Balinovcu probili obruč i uspeli su da se izvuku iz toga. Ali su u obruču ostale većina jedinica, ostale centralna bolnica, ostale su ranjenici, ostale negde oko, po nemačkim izveštajima, oko 5700 izbrojanih leševa i oko 4000 procenjenih. Tako da su bili strašni gubici, potpuno neprimereni prema gubicima nemačkim i angažovanih snaga pod njihovom komandom, koji su oko 500 gubitaka imali u toj operaciji.
Britanske vojne misije stiču utisak o neverovatnoj borbenosti partizana, jer se nalaze upravo u epicentru tih borbi i njihovi izveštaji utiču da u stvari dođe do te prve drastične promjene kod Britanaca, koji kažu, pa da, u Jugoslaviji se ne bore četničke snage Mihailovića, nego upravo partizani, i to upravo s Nemcima, i to u situaciji kada se naša vojna misija tamo nalazi i sama također trpi gubitke.
Vladimir Velebit who reached an agreement with the Germans several months earlier, convinces Deakin that Mihailovich is a German collaborator.
It's rather ironic that it was actually Velebit who had been one of Tito's negotiators, parleying with the Germans during the March negotiations.
Operation Schwarz didn't destroy Mihailovich, but it did damage him in the eyes of the British, who now take note of the partisan guerrilla activity. In 1941 and 1942, they advised Mihailovich to lay low. Now they want him to take overt action. The Intelligence Center, located in Bletchley Park outside of London, houses a supercomputer, which is able to decrypt the German secret code Enigma. This gives the British a better picture of activity on various front lines, including Yugoslavia. Reports from Bletchley Park add weight to Deakin's dispatches from Suchiska.
He initially started out advising all the time that the support for Mihailovich should be maintained. And he did this throughout 1942, and he did this during the beginning of 1943. Which you can clearly see from his reports that were going up to the chiefs of staff through the various channels, that his opinion changed.
Pa jedino se od Mihailovića i od Srba tražilo da napadaju Nemce neprestano, tražilo se i od drugih, ali su oni odbijali s obzirom na čvrstinu okupacijskog režima. Mihailoviću se to pripisivalo kao izdaja.
Churchill in particular didn't appreciate the reprisals. Whereas when it came to the French Marquis being in the forest and being threatened with reprisals, and Churchill would tell them to go easy. And there was this what people would refer to as British double standards.
British wanted to be in the driving seat, and Mihailovich, not unsurprisingly in his own country, also felt he should be in control of the situation.
Rome was free, liberated after 21 years.
In September of 1943, Italy capitulates. The British Army's plan, prepared with Mihailovich to invade in Yugoslavia, was shelved. The Allies continue their push from North Africa into Italy. Mihailovich launches a large-scale offensive now that the Italian troops in Yugoslavia have surrendered. Recently discovered documents from the Bundesarchive show that the offensive's ultimate goal was Sarajevo, held by the Germans and the independent state of Croatia forces, the Ustashi. In spite of the now tense relations with the British, SOE paratroopers, commanded by Brigadier Armstrong, the new head of the British mission to Mihailovich, participate in the offensive, fighting alongside Chetniks.
Kao vojvoda rudničkog korpusa, na primjer, ja sam tu moju zastavu nosio do Goražde i kad je to sve popadalo, ostalo u krvi, na primjer, i onda trojka je pratila moju zastavu, dvojica su mi ostali živi, jedan mi je poginuo, zastava mi je sva bila kao šito izbušena, kad je najveća borba bivala. A ja, pored stroja, viče, hrabro, braćo, za kralja i otrču. I nikad ne preželjam, možu braću, ne mogu da je preželim. I onda vidim ostado, izgibe to sve ostao krvi, Drina već postaje krvava, nije više onaj...
Unfortunately, the BBC broadcast a report, a of all this action that had been taken and the Visegrad bridge being blown up and so forth, and attributed it all to the partisans. To say that Mihailovic's forces were disappointed would be an understatement.
The BBC had a fairly crucial role in the whole business of information or disinformation.
Dalje od Višegrada sa jedinicama Jugoslovenske vojske nisu išli savjetnički oficiri. Dokumente Jugoslovenske vojske su ili negde sklonjene ili su uništene, a savjetnička ne postoji iz prostog razloga što nije bio nijednog savjetnika tamo. Nemačka niko nije doneo u vojni arhiv u Beogradu.
Dokumenta koja govore o jeseni 43. godine su vrlo značajna. Značajne su zbog toga što govore o najvećoj antiosovinskoj operaciji koja je provedena na tlu Kraljevine Jugoslavije.
Kompletne osovinske formacije povlače se dalje prema Sarajevu i prave novu, praktično poslednju liniju odbrane u pravcu Sokolac-Mokropale. U međuvremenu Nemci dovode pojačanja, čak iz Albanije dovode 92. motorizovani puk, to im je bila interventna jedinica za Balkan. Jugoslovenska vojska počinje artiljerijsku pripremu, gađajući Sokolac, a odlučujući napad bio je zakazan za 22. oktobar 43. godine u ranim jutarnjim časovima. Dva časa pre toga, jedinice Jugoslovenske vojske i sa leva i sa desna, svim raspoloživim, svim pokretnim snagama koje su imali, napadaju komunisti. Znači, drugi udarni korpus sa juga, treći udarni korpus sa severa. Sve je to zanimljivo. Zanimljivo je što su Nemci videli za komunističke jedinice kreću prema položajima jedinica generala Mihailovića. Ali oni su smatrali da one tamo idu kako bi zajedno sa jedinicama generala Mihailovića napale njih, Nemce. Zašto su Nemci tako mislili? Zašto su bili naivni? Zato što su videli da i kod jednih i kod drugih postoje engleske vojne misije. I oni su bili ubeđeni da su one engleske vojne misije kod formacije komunističke partije i one engleske vojne misije kod jugoslovenske vojske uspele da izglade stvar, da sve staje pod jednu komandu i da njih zajedno napadu. Kada su 22. oktobru zoru ustaši javile da partizani sa leđa napadaju jugoslovensku vojsku i da je front jugoslovenske vojske slomljen, da je napad na ustaše prestao, Nemci nisu verovali. Dva dana Nemci nisu poverovali da su partizani zapravo svim svojim snagama udarili u leđa četnicima. A to je bilo tako.
I don't think anyone reading this material could come to anything other than the conclusion that it was the partisans who were providing most of the resistance to the Germans, and that's why I have no doubt whatsoever that Churchill took the decision to support the partisans.
Ja ne mislim da je on na osnovu tih podataka doneo svoju odluku, nego su mu oni samo poslužili da unapred done tu odluku opravda.
American President Woodrow Wilson was the greatest advocate of the creation of Yugoslavia at the end of World War I. My grandfather, Milorad Drašković, was the signatory of the Declaration for the Creation of Yugoslavia and a minister in the first government. Conceived as an ideal state which will unify all southern Slavs, Yugoslavia proved to be costly in World War II. The policy of killing and expulsion of Serbian civilians in the independent state of Croatia weighs heavily on Mihailovic, who has to uphold his constitutional oath and defend Yugoslavia while protecting Serbian interests. A small Serbian village is Yugoslavia's last chance.
Because the Germans occupied Belgrade, this school in the village of Ba, at the foot of Ravna Gora, became the National Parliament of Yugoslavia. At the invitation of General Mihailovic, deputies from 12 political parties, which made up the pre-war Parliament of Yugoslavia, gathered here, including the pre-war president of the parliament, who chaired the session. They arrived in secrecy, avoiding the Gestapo on the way. When it was over, all of them lent support to Mihailović's defense of Yugoslavia.
Oni su govorili da treba Srbija da bude od Đevđelije do srpskih Moravica. Bili su ekstremni nacionalisti, dok smo mi bili za demokratiju i istovremeno smo bili da se održi Jugoslavija, da se kažne svi oni koji su učinili zločine, ali da se održi Jugoslavija kao država.
There were still suggestions all the time that perhaps there could be spheres of influence where the Chetniks would have their sphere of influence there and the partisan, they would just steer clear of each other. But by the end of 1943, Churchill took the decision, no, it's not going to work.
The future of Yugoslavia is being decided not inside the country, but in Tehran by the Allies. Tehran also signals the first glimpse of the post-war order. Roosevelt is looking at a direct deal with Stalin, focusing on Western Europe. The British want to keep their influence in the Mediterranean and Eastern Europe.
Suština je u tome što je britanska politika davala ton i dinamiku prema Balkanu, a da su Amerikanci samo to sledili.
The Americans realize the Soviet army is gaining on the Germans in the east. Roosevelt is ready to cede Eastern Europe to Stalin. The British and the Soviets will both back Tito, who is agreeable to their interests and strategy, unlike Mihailović. However, one American is cautious about the new British reports coming from Yugoslavia. The head of the Office of Strategic Services, General Bill Donovan, sends the first American mission to Mihailović, headed by Lieutenant Colonel Seitz and Captain Mansfield. The American mission is formally under British Brigadier Armstrong.
And Armstrong, undoubtedly acting upon orders that he had been given, held Seitz and Mansfield to a very close leash. He didn't allow them much freedom of action. They soon wearied of that, deciding they weren't being of much use there, and decided that they would make a tour of their own, which they did through a sizable area in Serbia.
Mihailović appoints Captain Borislav Todorović, his liaison officer with Allied missions, to take the Americans on a walkabout tour.
They traveled everywhere to see how many men were there that were fighting for Mihailović. Who were they? Because they couldn't see it with their own two eyes.
In late 1943, U.S. Captain Walter Mansfield spent months with General Mihailović and his staff, writing down his observations for his report. Here are just a few of his excerpts. There is complete distrust of the British by Mihailović and his leaders, who feel the British have sold them down the river to Stalin. Another excerpt. I saw no collaboration between Chetniks and Germans in Serbia. And finally, a third one. The Serbian people are tremendously enthusiastic for Americans. They refer to Americans as the only nation which has no ultimate designs on them.
The British had decided that they were going to drop Mihailović, abandon him. Donovan resisted that. He did not favor doing that. And when he stated his objections to that, he attached a copy of Mansfield's report to his objection to, in effect, support the idea that we should not abandon Mihailović or withdraw the missions from Serbia.
Mihailović wanted Bora to go to Roosevelt and ask for help.
Ahead of us are much bigger fights. We and our allies will go into them as we went into Sicily, together. And we shall carry on together.
After submitting their reports to Donovan, Seitz, Mansfield, and Todorović are presented with a gift from President Roosevelt.
It was about that time when the Four Freedoms had been printed, which I had the original, in Serbian. Roosevelt had done it in Serbian. And he personally gave the Four Freedoms to be given to Mihailović.
The Four Freedoms were painted by the American artist Norman Rockwell and published in a special edition of the Saturday Evening Post. They symbolize freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. But while he gifts Draža with art, Roosevelt sends weapons to Tito using American planes stationed in Italy. In spite of Donovan's favorable view of Mihailović, Roosevelt follows Churchill's lead on Yugoslavia. Admiral Bulkley, who once graced the same comic book cover with Draža, is sent to help the partisans, who are now on the Adriatic coast. He is accompanied by the great American director John Ford. In Ford's authorized biography, Bulkley testifies as to American split loyalties, quote, Ford was anti-communist and supported Tito's rival Mihailović. Tito was a full-blown commie. Mihailović was the good guy, unquote.
One of the most outspoken officers from OSS who went into the partisan side and who was very openly pro-partisan was the movie actor Sterling Hayden. In his initial report, very flattering about the partisan movement, even he came to view later, and he said that the idea that there is liberated territory in Yugoslavia by the partisans is, in his words, pure bunkum. That's his phrase. Not a military phrase, but that's his phrase. So the idea that Tito is the liberator of Yugoslavia, I think, flies in the face of the evidence that is there.
Bogart, glad to be back.
Who's
well,
said
you
it?
Both did a swell job.
Thank you, Mr.
Bogart.
Nice.
Now,
give us a lot of good news.
How are our boys doing?
Our boys are doing a great job. On our trip overseas, my wife and I saw thousands of American boys in Africa and Italy, and you can be awfully proud of them.
But as the Allies are getting ready to leave Mihailović, it turns out they need him more than ever. American planes that bomb Hitler's last remaining oil fields in Romania are shot down by German air defenses over Serbia on their way back to Italy. Mihailović is the only one who can rescue them.
And the briefing officer explained all the details about the mission and the altitude we would bomb at and so on and so forth. Then he made an interesting comment. And he said, if you have to bail out over Yugoslavia, stay away from the Chetniks and seek out the partisans, because the Chetniks are collaborating with the Germans. Of course, nothing could be further from the truth.
What do you want me to do with them, said Mihailović. What do you want me to do with them? And that's when Bora made the contact with the Americans, that we had the American airmen there. So that was, that's really, we knew that first. I knew that first.
Gospodar Jevremove number 5, this is where my family lived, in Belgrade. In 1944, my father left here to go to Ravna Gora to join with Mihailović, and he was there during the rescue of the airmen. Years later in the U.S., he met the man responsible for that rescue, George Vujinović. This was the last interview he ever gave.
U Bari sam postao šef za operacije za sve te avione i podučavanje i treniranje i sve planove.
It was just so well planned by George Vujinović. He was the architect of this great escape.
Kad su Englezi to saznali, oni su rekli Churchill da ne može da Vujinović ide kod Draže. Ja sam onda išao tomu generalu koji su to vojnici bili i kaže, ja ne mogu ništa da radim, jer to je englesko područje. Ja kažem, to su vaši vojnici. Da li su to engleska komanda tamo, to ne je firma. I on je rekao, ja ću onda postati avione da ih skupi.
By mid-1944, hundreds of U.S. airmen are gathered by Mihailović's commanders from across Yugoslavia and dispatched to his headquarters near Ravna Gora for the airlift. The operation, codenamed Halyard, was classified until recently. Halyard is significant for another reason. The Americans had a camera crew filming the operation. It is the only footage of Mihailović shot during the war. Archivist Bonnie Rowan discovered the footage at the National Archives in Washington, D.C., 70 years after it was filmed.
At NARA, I work with paper records, I work with photographs, but mostly I work with motion pictures. And when there was nothing that I could find in motion pictures, I went to the paper records. And the paper records are very strong in talking about the various people who worked with Mihailović, what he was accomplishing, various reports from the Office of Strategic Services. And so up to a point, they were very, very positive. And now we've found the film.
As the Americans are arriving, the last representative of the British mission leaves Mihailović's headquarters.
It was a very meticulous combing through of many different film reels before we actually uncovered these particular shots. Films give visual evidence of American Special Forces interaction with Mihailović and some of his crews during the Operation Halyard.
A 10-year-old boy comes running up, yelling, "Nemci, Nemci," which meant Germans. So the Chetnik that was with me handed me a homemade hand grenade. I don't know whether I was more frightened of the hand grenade or the Germans. And we went up into the hills, and 2 minutes later, the Germans came by, 2 truckloads. They were the kindest people that you could ever want to meet. You know, they greeted us with open arms, contrary to what we were told when we went to briefing.
I kad smo se lepo porazumeli, ja kažem, Amerika je ovde, na primjer, a oni kažu, Srbija je ovde, nak i mene dođu, raskopčaju mi ovo, ljube mi grudi.
In spite of support from political parties in the country and from the government in exile, Mihailović receives a blow from which Serbia and Yugoslavia never recover. On September 6, 1944, the general and his Chetniks wait for the annual King's birthday speech broadcast on BBC. But the King does not speak that day, a sign that something is wrong. He makes the speech 6 days later, but the subject matter is anything but celebratory. Under pressure from Churchill, the now 21-year-old King Peter publicly disavows General Mihailović and throws his support behind Tito.
Saznali smo u Bosni, kad sam ja rekao kralju Petre, ako si ovo rekao, izdao ovaj proglas, što se nisi ubio, nego si Srbiju sranio.
The British were fearful that Donovan was going to take advantage of the aircrew rescue unit being in there to send in another mission, and of course that's exactly what he was planning to do. And he did it in a way to keep it secret from the British or anyone else for that matter.
Donovan conceives of Operation Halyard as a cover for Operation Ranger. The two operations overlap. This is why Colonel Robert McDowell can be seen in the footage featuring the rescue of the airmen. However, he is there for an entirely different reason. The Germans still held communication routes in major towns in Serbia, but they know they are fighting a losing war.
McDowell tried to negotiate that the Germans would actually surrender to Mihailović. And he had a meeting with Mihailović. I actually met someone who was present at that meeting. And the suggestion seemed to be that if Mihailović and his forces could actually reach Banja Luka and establish a power base there, that the Americans would be prepared to recognize them as an alternative government to Tito's Avnoj.
The American Ranger mission, headed by Colonel McDowell, offers the Germans to end the war in southern Europe. The entire German Balkan army is to surrender to Mihailović and the American special forces.
They had plans of using the Chetnik headquarters as a home base to send units into Eastern European countries.
To govori o tome da je Mihailović, što aktivno, što pasivno, kontrolisao ipak veći deo teritorije Srbije.
Donovan receives orders from President Roosevelt to withdraw McDowell from Yugoslavia. Roosevelt assures Churchill this will happen shortly, but McDowell decides to extend his stay.
And McDowell and his people make a wide survey of the area. They go into different parts of the country. And what they find is that the partisans are overwhelmingly turning their supplies and their energy toward the nationalists, the Chetniks, not the Germans.
Tito tries to reach Serbia and meet the advancing Red Army. But the Soviets are first met by Mihailović's men on the Danube.
Njegove snage su od septembra do negde novembra delovale zajedno sa sovjetskim snagama na svim tačkama gde su došli u dodir. Znači od sovjetskog prelaska Dunava negde u septembru pa do borbi u zahvatu Pomoravlja i gradova kakvi su Deligrad, Aleksinac, Kruševac, Čačak.
Mihailović's troops liberate Kruševac on October 14, 1944. The Soviet envoy Major Prunin and the American envoy Lieutenant Kramer greet the Chetniks alongside cheering crowds.
Ali se u nekoliko slučajeva to savezništvo uz prisustvo partizana koje takođe se pojavljuje na tom terenu već u sledećim danima, u stvari menja u jedno neprijateljstvo. Tako da, pored zajedničkih borbi oko nekih gradova, sovjetske snage već posle nekoliko dana te iste snage razoružavaju i predaju partizanima koji u nekoliko slučajeva odmah vrše streljanje tih ljudi.
O tome postoje jasne analize koje pokazuju da bi pokret otpora bio mnogo efikasniji da je vođen pod jedinstvenom komandom, da je bio koordinisan sa ostalim snagama antifašističke koalicije i da je iskoristio prave trenutke za otpor. I on je, da bi izbegao sukob sa Sovjetima koje je smatrao i dalje svojim saveznicima, odlučio da se povuče u Bosnu.
On December 27, 1944, the last group of Americans are airlifted with Mihailovich's help. They plead with the general that he board the plane as well, but he refuses, saying, "It is my duty to stay with my people until the end."
Američka praktičnost da dođu do cilja najjednostavnijim putem i na najkraći mogući način, u stvari, pobedila sve ostale strategije koje su predlagali Britanci, a koje su uglavnom imali kontekst možda čak i Prvog svjetskog rata, znači dejstvo iz Mediterana nekako u središte Evrope. Amerikanci su procenili da je to najefikasnije ako se učini od severa Francuske direktno u srce Trećeg Rajha.
That spirit of free people, working, fighting, and living together in one great cause, has served us well on the Western Front. We in the field pray that that spirit of comradeship will persist forever among the free peoples of the United Nations.
In June of 1946, Tito organizes a mock trial of Mihailovich in Belgrade, where everything seems to be turned on its head. The prosecutor claims partisans were the first to attack the Germans, not the Chetniks at Loznica. The indictment is framed around Mihailovich's two meetings with the Germans. In 1941, he met with them to stop the reprisals. Following the meeting, the Germans launched an offensive against him. In 1944, he met the Germans to accept their offer to surrender. However, the prosecution portrays these meetings as proof that he was a collaborator from the beginning to the end of the war. Infiltration with NATO forces and Chetnik agreements with Italians, which were encouraged by the SOE, are labeled collaboration. Mihailovich's Yugoslav army officers, the only ones who did not surrender to the Germans in 1941, are proclaimed German collaborators.
To je Draža Mihajlović. Bio je osnivač četničkog pokreta pod prividnom tezom da okuplja snage protiv okupatora. A kada je Komunistička partija Jugoslavije pozvala narod na ustanak, on je stupio u saradnju sa nemačkim i italijanskim okupatorima.
The Cold War is starting, and the trial witnesses unexpected bizarre moments. The Western Allies, which helped install Tito a year earlier, are now being targeted by the prosecution. McDowell and the heads of the British missions, Hudson, Bailey, and Armstrong, are accused of being too close to Mihailovich during the war and of conspiring with him against the communist revolution. All three heads of the British mission, who argued with Mihailovich over strategy and inactivity, offered to testify on his behalf in Belgrade, but are denied.
Bailey refuted allegations of collaboration against Mihailovich by saying it makes no more sense to say that Mihailovich's forces infiltrating Nedic is an indication of collaboration with the Germans than to say that we are collaborating with Hitler because we have spies in Germany.
Over 100 witnesses are called by the defense, but the judge only allows two witnesses to testify. Two women come to the defense of General Mihailovich. The film of Mihailovich's trial is the first theatrically distributed Yugoslav production after the war. It will play a key role in the creation of a new ideology, providing the blueprint for numerous World War II movies filmed during Tito's rule. Nearly all of them show partisans as heroes and Chetniks as collaborators and war criminals. While Mihailovich was on trial in Belgrade, he was praised in New York City. American journalist Dorothy Thompson, organized a commission for a fair trial of General Mihailović, which held a week-long series of hearings examining evidence in Mihailović's favor.
The New York County Lawyers Association opened its doors to have the hearings held here from May 13th to 18th of 1946. Those hearings were chaired by Arthur Garfield Hayes. Hayes was a founding member of the New York County Lawyers Association and also was famous for defending the Scopes, Scottsboro, and Reichstag trials.
Hayes' association with Thompson and her popularity raised the public profile of the hearings. Thompson, the leading journalist of her era, was the first foreign correspondent expelled from Germany by Hitler. Katharine Hepburn portrayed her in the movie Woman of the Year. The Commission of Inquiry, organized by Thompson and presided over by Hayes, is made up of judges, attorneys, United States senators, and congressmen.
We protested in front of the Yugoslav embassy. We sent letters to the Yugoslav embassy saying we wanted to testify on behalf of Mihailović, and we were denied.
More than 20 airmen and officers testified in person, and more than 300 affidavits were submitted in evidence, all asserting that General Mihailović was an ally.
General Mihailović was awarded medals by Generals de Gaulle and Sikorsky for his struggle on behalf of the Allies. At the recommendation of General Eisenhower, President Harry Truman posthumously awarded Mihailović the Legion of Merit Medal for contributions to Allied victory. It is the highest award an American president can bestow on a foreigner. The award was immediately classified.
It would be interesting to know what Mihailović's thoughts were at the end. You have here an individual who, in 1941, when England had no allies on the continent, threw in his lot with Britain. And to believe that he then, in 1943 and 44, when the war was clearly being won by the Allies and lost by the Germans, would then throw his lot in with the Germans is inexplicable. And that makes no sense.
Deco moja, sad vam se predstavlja kralja Petra Vojnik, runički vojvoda, goškog cara, draže generala, koji kroz svoj život oplakuje tužnu majku Srbiju, svetlu krunu Karađorđevića, gorskog cara Dražu generala i svoju ljubljenu zastavu, što je nisam s kraljem Petrom na Oplencu razbio.
Nikada, ni sa jednim nepetem, nisam zaključio nikakav sporaz. Bifor svetski odnao je mene i moj rad.
In his final statement, General Mihailović's voice was calm and resolute. He spoke for over an hour. The courtroom, which was usually hostile, sat in complete silence, listening to his every word. When he was done, he walked back to his chair and waited for the verdict. Guilty, death by firing squad. A few days later, he was buried at an undisclosed site. Mihailović's Yugoslavia was sold to Stalin. Draža had to disappear. Nobody needs heroes when the war is over. They're expendable, but some, the very few, are never forgotten.